On this edition of Distro Roundup, we're going to take a look at the recent releases of OpenIndiana, OpenMandriva, ArcoLinux, Peppermint, and RoboLinux. Let's get started. OpenIndiana just had a big release about a week ago. They released version 2019.04. OpenIndiana is an interesting project because it is derived from the old OpenSolaris project. I'm sure you guys remember OpenSolaris. Now it's called OpenIndiana, and it is an Illumos-based Unix operating system, Unix-like operating system. We can't call it Unix. It has to be called a Unix-like operating system for trademark reasons. You could actually get sued calling a Unix-like operating system Unix. So we have to be careful talking about any of the Unixes or BSD distros or Linux distros. All of them have to be called Unix-like operating systems. Anyway, 2019.04, the release notes here, I gotta be honest, it is not a great release announcement here. Half the release notes here for this version, by the way, the code name is Hipster. I love the code name Hipster. That, of course, is a meme word these days, so that's kind of nice. But half the page here is a GPG key. Why they felt the need to publish that, I'm not sure. And then they give you instructions on how to verify the key, some other information here. But basically, you have like three paragraphs here of interesting information. And it's basically the software, what versions they're updated to. So for desktop software, Mate 1.22 is now the desktop environment. Firefox was updated to version 60 ESR. VirtualBox 6.0 was integrated, including the guest editions, some common tools and libraries you might be interested in. Many of the utilities on OpenIndiana are now 64-bit only. They're moving away from 32-bit, like most other distributions out there. All the common shells you would expect are here, ZSH, Bash, PDSH. GNU Alk has been updated to 5.0. GNU SID was updated to 4.7. GNU Core Utils was updated to 8.31. And some server software, Apache 2.4 is included. It is 64-bit only now. OpenSSH was updated to 7.9p1. So let's take a quick look at OpenIndiana 2019.04. This is just the live environment. I pulled down the ISO. This is not going to be a review or even really an overview. You guys just want to check out OpenIndiana for a couple of minutes. This is the live environment. It's the Mate 1.22 desktop. It's the standard traditional GNOME 2 style layout for Mate. So you have your top panel, your bottom panel. It's kind of retro as far as the look. It kind of looks a little dated, but you know what? It looks good. It's actually a clean look. I don't mind the look. I like the blue wallpaper against the silver panels. I like the OI logo here, the OpenIndiana logo. As far as branding and theming and everything, it looks pretty good. Under applications, we don't have a lot of applications installed here, but under accessories, we have character map, desktop search, the usual suspects, right? The archive manager, calculator, font viewer, the Mate search tool, Pluma, which is our text editor, plain text editor, and of course, we have the screenshot utility under graphics. We don't really have anything. You have your image viewer and the color selection tool, but you don't have any real graphics utilities like GIMP or Blender, Inkscape, Shotwell, anything like that. Under internet, don't have much here. We have the Avahi server browser. We have Firefox. And again, Firefox is going to be version 60 ESR. That's the extend support release. We have Pigeon, which is the internet messaging client. That's an interesting choice. I'm not sure how many people really use instant messaging these days. Thunderbird is the email client. And we have Tiger VNC Viewer. Tiger VNC Viewer is used to connect to remote machines. This is Tiger VNC Viewer 64-bit. Again, we're getting rid of all the 32-bit applications on the machines these days. So version 1.8.0 for Tiger VNC. Under the Office category, nothing here, no LibreOffice suite. We have Atrol, which is our document viewer, our PDF viewer. We have the Mate dictionary. Under programming, we have Glade, which I believe is a development tool for those wanting to play with GTK development. Sound and video, nothing really here, actually. We don't even like have a movie player or audio player of any kind. All we have, oddly enough, they shipped Brazero, which is a disk burning utility. How many people burn CDs and DVDs anymore? Not that many. And then the CD Ripper utility makes even less sense. You probably didn't even have to ship these two. And then you have this sound program here. Under system tools, we have the Avahi browser again. Kaha. Kaha is the file manager for the Mate desktop environment 1.22.1. Caja is actually a really nice file manager. And also under System Tools, we have our driver utility, gparted for the partition editor. Now, that may or may not actually be on OpenIndiana if I'd actually done the install. This may be live environment only. A lot of distributions, they'll have gparted on the live image. That way you can use the live USB stick, you know, as a rescue stick or something. But when you actually go through the install, they may remove gparted. I'm not sure if OpenIndiana does that, but it's possible. Other than that, we have the disk usage analyzer, the Monte system monitor. Let's open that up. Let's see what kind of system resources we're using. Again, this is a live environment. I didn't even install this. This is just strictly running it off the live image. So, yeah, we're using about 1 gig of RAM of the 4 gigs of memory I gave this VM that I'm running in. And the CPU usage is a little higher than normal. But again, we opened up a lot of programs, and this isn't a real install. This is just a live environment here. Got a little bit going on up here, too. We've got some stuff sitting in the sys tray. We have the volume control, network, configure time slider, and that looks like to be the power. Yeah, power management preferences. So those of you on laptops, of course, would want to play with that a little bit. All in all, it looks very sparse. I mean, there is not much to it. You do have a control center, which is all your standard setting stuff. You would expect, you know, all of this to be here, you know, for setting up displays, keyboard, mouse, power management, maybe adding users, changing the appearance if you wanted to play around with some of the theming here in Mate. I'm not going to do that. Again, this is just a live environment. That was just a quick look, though, at OpenIndiana 2019.04. OpenMandriva had a big release this week, too. They released the release candidate for OpenMandriva LX 4.0, and their release announcement is rather short and to the point as well. Quote, "Dear community, we're almost there. Last step before the long-awaited OpenMandriva LX 4.0 is released." So this is the release candidate. This is the last step before the official release, but the release candidates for most distributions are rather stable. This is kind of like the last thing they put out a couple of weeks before the real ISO drops. Core packages that were updated include kernel 5.1.0, KDE Plasma 5.15.5, KDE Frameworks 5.57, KDE Applications 1904.1, Qt Framework 5.12. Systemd is now on version 2.42. They also ship with Java 12, LibreOffice 6.2.4, Firefox Quantum 66.0.5, Krita 4.1.8, etc., etc. Let's take a quick look at OpenMandriva LX 4.0, the release candidate. I did pull down the ISO. And here is OpenMandriva LX 4.0, the release candidate. First things first, I love the welcome greeter here. This is really, really neat. It's got several tabs at the top. Well, welcome to OpenMandriva. First, it's going to tell you just a brief overview what OpenMandriva is. OpenMandriva LX is an exciting free desktop operating system that aims to cater to and interest first-time and advanced users alike. And I would say that this is very much geared toward the new user because just going through it, I mean, we have the welcome screen, then we have features. It tells you all about the features that are included, I guess for advanced users as well, because probably most new users don't care about kernel information, Plasma version, things like that, what version of LibreOffice you're running, EFI boot, that's interesting. We have the configure tab at the top. What does that configure the network? Okay, desktop themes, display. Yeah, configuring the system. It's all right here in the greeter. I love this. This is one of the better greeters I've seen lately. Actually, applications. Go ahead and install some of your favorite applications. Again, right here in the greeter. How to contribute to the project, of course. So you have the instruction manual, their forms, translations, artwork, mailing lists, bug reporting, their IRC channel, and of course how to donate to the project. And last, you have the about this program, which is just licensing information. This software is licensed under the GNU GPL version 2. Taking a very quick look at the live environment here. Beautiful, beautiful. Plasma 5.15.5 looks gorgeous. I love the wallpaper. The OpenMandriva 4 wallpaper looks good. Just everything about it, the theming. I love the dark theming. It's got a little transparency too in the menus here. Let's take a look just very briefly what is installed by default on OpenMandriva. I expect it has quite a bit more applications installed than what OpenIndiana had. So under the internet category, we have Aggregator, which is KDE's RSS feed reader, Falcon, which is the web browser, it used to be Cupzilla, now it's called Falcon. What version of Falcon are we on? Falcon 3.1.0. I actually haven't played with Falcon. I actually should install Falcon at some point on one of my drives and play with it. People tell me good things about it. I haven't really tried it. Well, you have your IM contacts, the standard KDE applications, KGIT, the log viewer, KMail for an email client, which is an okay email client. I would probably just install Thunderbird, though. Conversation with a K is a great IRC chat client. Copete, KRDC, KTorrent, and a few more K applications under the internet category. Under Office, no real Office suite here either. No, they are under the More category. You have to go down here and click More because we've got all of this superfluous stuff. Most people probably are not going to use Contact and K-Organizer and all that, but once you get to the L's here, LibreOffice, Calc, Draw, Impress, and Writer are all here. Under the Graphics category, we have a few things installed. Digicam, GwenView, Krita, Ocular, Scanlight. Under the More, we have LibreOffice Draw. Sound and Video, Camoso, which is a webcam app, Kden Live, which is a fantastic video editor, probably the best free and open source video editor we have, K-Wave Sound Editor, Simple Screen Recorder, which is great if all you want to do is just record your desktop. You know, that Simple Screen Recorder is fantastic. SM Player for video player, VLC Media Player is also installed. VLC is probably the best multimedia player we have as far as free and open source software. MPV is also on the system. A variety of tools such as Arc, which is the archive manager, Kate, which is the plain text editor, KCalc, console with a K, and that's KDE's console. Let's open up console real quick. Let's do a quick uname, because I don't remember actually what version of the kernel they said they shipped with, so, and I am struggling with my new keyboard. 5.1.0, and that's a very recent kernel. Do they have HTOP on the system? I'm not sure. HTOP is installed by default. That's cool. And for Plasma, we were just looking at Mate in a live environment. Look at Plasma. 649 megs of the 4 gigs of RAM I gave this machine. Of course, I didn't look in OpenIndiana. I didn't look in HTOP. I was using a different system monitor. That does affect things. I like to try to look at everything in HTOP. That way, you know, there's some consistency there. I go back to tools very quickly. Midnight Commander is on the system, which is basically our terminal file manager. Not bad. Midnight Commander is pretty good. For those of you that like terminal file managers like Ranger, VIFM, Midnight Commander is very usable too. We have our system settings, games, no real games installed. Education, not much here. KCalc and LibreOffice Math. Check out the system settings. This is your standard system settings manager here in KDE Plasma. And let's check out what kind of themes are installed by default. Just Breeze, Breeze Dark, and OpenMandriva, which is selected. And I think the OpenMandriva theme, to me, it looks like it's the Breeze Dark theme. So no real themes. If I right-click on the desktop and choose Configure Desktop, do we have any wallpapers to choose from? Not much. We have the OpenMandriva wallpaper and a couple of the standard Plasma wallpapers, but yeah, no real wallpapers to choose from. But overall, the look and feel of OpenMandriva, just playing with it for a couple of minutes, looks fantastic. I did get a pop-up a second ago saying there were about 340 updates to the system. This release candidate came out a few days ago, maybe 5-6 days ago, so there's a lot of updates just in the last few days. But again, the release candidate, they're getting ready for the release, so it would make sense why there's a ton of updates available. If I wanted to update the system, I would go to Tools, and then System Tools, and then they have DNF Dragora Updater. And I believe that is the tool that... it's already sitting in the sys tray. I didn't need to open it. All I needed to do was click update, and it will update the system for me. But again, this is a live environment. No point in me doing that. ArcoLinux release 19.5 this week. ArcoLinux is a great Linux distribution. I've actually run ArcoLinux on several of my machines here in the past. I installed their awesome window manager edition on one of my laptops last year and ran it for a month or two. I installed their BSPWM edition and ran it on one of my laptops for about 3 months last year. I currently have ArcoLinux, their Xmonad edition, running on one of my laptops. And of course, I run ArcoLinux on my main production machine, so I'm a big fan of ArcoLinux. So they just had a big release just a couple of days ago. On May 15th, they released version 19.5. So the big releases for ArcoLinux, ArcoLinux D, and ArcoLinux B. And they have a ton of images. I don't know how they maintain all of them, but they have a lot of ISOs out there for download because they support so many different window managers. And then they have the three different types of Arco. Arco, and then Arco Linux D, Arco Linux B. So what has changed? Well, they're spending some time on the development of their awesome window manager edition, which is great. It's what I actually live in right now is Arco Awesome. And it seems like they're changing a little bit of the code. 19 files changed, 231 additions, 317 deletions. So they've done a little bit of work on the Awesome edition. There's some great screenshots. Arco Linux, the artwork and the wallpapers and the theming and everything is really spot on. If you're one of those people that it's very visual and like something that just looks modern and slick, Arco Linux is just a fantastic distribution. Now, they do mention that they will be building less and less Arco Linux B ISOs in the future. So right now, I think they have something like 15 or so Arco Linux B ISOs, one for pretty much every window manager known to man. And I guess it's a lot of work. Quote, it takes a lot of energy for the Arco team and all the beta testers to test all the ISOs. There currently are Arco Linux and Arco Linux D ISOs. They want to reduce it by, or they actually have two. There are Arco Linux B full ISOs. There's 13 of those. Arco Linux B minimal ISOs. There's also 13 of those. So that's 28 ISOs that they have to test every month. I guess that's quite a drain as far as time, energy, and they need to slim down a little bit. So, and the idea of one of these build-it-yourself kind of distros like Arco is really touted as you download it. It's kind of a minimal download. You decide what goes on it. You play with the GitHub scripts and with the Arco Linux D installs, and the Arco Linux B installs, you can also decide what exactly gets installed before you run the installation. So it's kind of a build-it-yourself project, so it doesn't really make sense for them to have all these full ISOs anyway, because the idea is you guys need to build it yourself. So I think they're going to start slimming down very shortly on the number of ISOs. Super plus Q is now a hotkey pretty much all the window manager editions, because they recently released a Qtile version of Arco Linux. You guys know my favorite tiling window manager of all time is probably Qtile. And when Arco Linux was releasing all these versions with i3 and Xmonad and BSPWM and Awesome, you know, I'd made the comment, man, it would be great if they released a Qtile version, because nobody knows about Qtile. Qtile really flies under the radar. Without the stuff I do here on YouTube touting Qtile, I don't think most people would know about Qtile. So I said, you know what, it would be great if Arco made a Qtile version. And I guess these guys were listening, they made a Qtile version. And one of the default key bindings in Qtile is super plus Q to close a window. And I guess while they were developing that, they loved that keyboard shortcut so much they implemented it in everything. XFCE, OpenBox, i3, Awesome, BSPWM, and Xmonad all use super Q now to close a window. OB Logout now has a new theme. So pretty substantial release announcement here. They also are saying there's more work to do in the future. They need to do more Arco Linux B Qtile tutorials. You know, Eric Dubois, the creator of Arco Linux, has a YouTube channel where he creates all these video tutorials. Fantastic resource. If you're not subscribed to Eric Dubois' YouTube channel, you really should be. I got to admit, as a huge Qtile fan, probably the biggest proponent of Qtile anywhere in the Linux world, I've got to check out the Qtile edition. So they don't have a Qtile edition that you can run in a live environment. All the Arco Linux ISOs, the live environment is XFCE. They use XFCE as the delivery system. So you actually have to install Arco Linux if you actually want to get things like Xmonad, Awesome, BSPWM, and all that. So I ran through the install. The install process was only like 10 minutes. And this is Arco Linux B with Qtile for the window manager. And I gotta say, looks good. I like the wallpaper. I love what they did with the panel. By the way, this panel, you guys are going to think it's Polybar because it looks like Polybar and Arco Xmonad and Arco BSPWM and all those other Arco editions. But Qtile has a great built-in panel, very themable, has a ton of widgets, and this is actually the Qtile panel. They just themed it basically the same way they themed all their Polybar editions. So you would think it's Polybar, but it's not. That's actually Qtile, actual bar, and I actually checked the source code just to make sure that was Qtile's bar and not Polybar. If I scroll down here, you get to this section here in Vim where this is the widget list for what's going on here in the bar here. And by the way, Qtile is configured and programmed entirely in Python, so super Q is now the hotkey to close windows here in Arco. So super and enter, of course, gets us a terminal. You have some NeoFetch information. Again, kernel 5.0.10. It's an Arch-based distribution. The ISO came out 3 or 4 days ago, so there may be some updates available. If I ran a sudo pacman-syu, there's probably a few updates to the system, but we're not going to bother with that. Super Q to close. Anyway, this was just to take a very quick look. I think super shift D gets us a command prompt here. This is D menu here. I'm pretty sure it's D menu, although Qtile does have its own run command launcher similar to D menu. This may be that, but I'm pretty sure that's D menu there. What is installed by default? I think I did the minimal install, so I don't know. Vivaldi is the browser, I think, in all the Arco Linux versions as far as the default browser. I guess Eric Dubois is a big fan of Vivaldi, but it's a fine browser. Anyway, I'm not going to spend any more time here in Arco Linux B Qtile. I just wanted to let you guys know this was available. All you guys, many of you guys asked me about how do I get into Qtile. You know, go pull down my configs and, you know, just play with my configs from my GitLab page. But if you want an easy way to get into Qtile, Arco Linux B Qtile edition. And you probably should grab it soon because since they're going to start scaling back on the number of ISOs they release, could be Qtile would be one of those. Maybe they don't develop any longer because, again, Qtile, not a very popular tiling window manager, at least I think it's actually criminally underrated, probably because it's written in Python. A lot of people assume Python, well, it must be slow and bloated and all this, but it's not. Qtile runs blazing fast. It's just as fast as DWM and Xmonad and all the other tiling window managers I've ever tried. So again, check out Arco Linux Qtile if you want an easy way to get into Qtile. Peppermint, of course, had their big release this week. Peppermint is based, of course, on Ubuntu, and Ubuntu recently had their big releases in 1904, but Peppermint doesn't base off the interim releases. Peppermint bases its releases off of the LTS releases of Ubuntu. So they're still basing off of the last LTS release, which is 1804. Peppermint is also interesting. It's one of the rare distros as far as it's not really a minimal distro. It's a proper desktop environment, really. But Peppermint does include both 64-bit and 32-bit images still. So those of you that still run ancient hardware that requires a 32-bit ISO, Peppermint 10 is still an option for you. Some of the big changes include the kernel version, kernel version 4.18, which is now on the rolling HWE 1804. Four-track. HWE is the hardware enablement track. So basically what that does is it's kind of a way to roll into the next kernel so you're not stuck on that Ubuntu 1804 kernel forever. So what you do is you install HWE kernels and HWE Xorg stacks, and now you kind of roll along. You're not always on the latest kernel, but say when Ubuntu released 1810 and went to the next kernel from 1804, Peppermint would do the same thing if you were on the HWE kernel. Same thing when 1904 was released, you went to that kernel. And the same thing on the next big release, which will probably be on one of the 5-point kernels, you'll get that kernel. So you're not on some, you know, 2-, 3-, 4-year-old kernel if you're running the LTS. And that hardware enablement stack for the kernel and Xorg, that is strictly for Ubuntu LTS releases, and of course distros based off the Ubuntu LTS. Now, by default, and this is a big change, proprietary NVIDIA graphics drivers are now installed automatically if you tick on that install third-party driver software stuff in the installation. It will actually install the proprietary NVIDIA graphics drivers. That's big. Now, they recommend that if you want the NVIDIA proprietary drivers, that's fine to tick that on. If you want NVIDIA 390, that's the drivers that ship standard with Peppermint 10. But if you want something a little more bleeding edge, such as the later drivers, 396, 410, 415, 418, 430, if you want those drivers, don't tick on that install third-party drivers thing. You need to go and install those really bleeding edge drivers. You need to go install the PPA for that. ICE is now on version 6.0.2. ICE now has support for isolated profiles for Chromium, Chrome, and Vivaldi SSBs. Firefox SSBs are always isolated, so there was no need to do any work on that. SSBs, by the way, are the site-specific browser. Updated applications include a lot of the standard 1804 updates from the May 14th, 2019 update. Nemo was updated to 4.0.6. Nemo is the file manager for Peppermint. Now, Peppermint is interesting. It is basically what used to be, we called it a hybrid distro because it was this strange hybrid of XFCE and LXDE. But as LXDE has kind of really died, there's no real development for LXDE anymore. Everybody they've moved on to LXQt for the LXDE development. So now really Peppermint is basically pretty much all XFCE. The only LXDE applications they use anymore, I think, are the LX session and the LX appearance applications. We also have updates to the Mint install, which is now 7.9.7, Mint Stick 1.39, NeoFetch 6.0.1, Zed 2.0.2, XPlayer 2.0.2, and XViewer 2.0.2. And let's take just a quick look at the live environment for Peppermint 10. So Peppermint 10, first thing you're going to notice is just beautiful theming and artwork. That's always been the case with Peppermint, but even more so now with Peppermint 10. I mean, just the XFCE, is the whisker menu and everything just looks great. Some beautiful artwork here. The default wallpaper, I think, was done by Carl Schneider. You guys know Carl Schneider. He does a lot of artwork for free and open source projects everywhere. I think he did the default Peppermint wallpaper here, and I think he also did the alternative Peppermint wallpaper here. Let's take a look at that. That is really, really nice. I think I would run with that one. And we've got a bunch of other wallpapers, various photographs, just some beautiful photographs. I like this butterfly here. I mean, just gorgeous wallpapers, gorgeous photos. Some interesting things you're going to notice right off the bat when you go searching through the menu here is you've got a bunch of stuff installed that you don't see installed on a lot of distros. So if I just go to all, we'll just get the entire list of everything installed. I'm just going to point out some things that just kind of jump out at me. So the first thing is Dropbox is here. I don't know if it's installed or if that's just a link to the installer, but that's kind of cool. A lot of Dropbox users out there use Linux. Firefox Send is also here. That is really nice. That's the new Firefox Send utility, which is, you know, it allows you to basically just drag and drop files and send them to the cloud for sharing. You can even make it private. You can encrypt it. A really nice service that Firefox is doing, Firefox Send. We have ICE, of course. We mentioned ICE in the release announcement. So this is where you could create your simple SSBs here. So your site-specific browsers. Also, we have Microsoft Office, the online Microsoft Office. So I'm assuming 365. We have links to Excel, OneNote, PowerPoint, and Word. This is not something you see on a lot of Linux distros because, of course, none of that stuff is free and open source software. Same with Dropbox, not free and open source software. But it's neat that they include maybe not the programs. They probably don't ship with the programs installed, but they at least ship with links so that you can actually get to the programs because I know a lot of people do use services like Office 365. For software, let's see what kind of software center we're using. Welcome to software. So it looks like it's the GNOME software center, which is okay. I don't hate the GNOME software center. Let's see, if I right click, I can choose close. By the way, the file manager is another interesting feature to Peppermint. So basically it is an XFCE distro. I mean, the desktop environment's XFCE, but you notice this is not Thunar. They do not use the Thunar file manager, which a lot of people think is one of the weakest points to XFCE is the file manager. I actually quite like Thunar, but Nemo is the hot new file manager these days. Everybody is switching to Nemo. Ubuntu Budgie switched to Nemo. A lot of people are using the Nemo file manager, which is, I think originally it was a fork of the old Nautilus file manager back when Nautilus was useful before the GNOME devs neutered it. So this is Nemo 4.0.6. Love the theming. I like the transparency when I open the about page. This is really cool. Of course, Peppermint is often touted as one of those new user-friendly distros where things typically just work. You install it, all your drivers just work out of the box, the install is very easy. You usually don't have to fight with Peppermint. Peppermint is great for putting friends and family on, especially if their machines are a little older, because again, we have XFCE as the desktop environment, so should be fast and light. Let's see if HTOP is installed by default here. Oh, I've got the caps lock on. Excuse me, guys. Still got my new keyboard here. I'm trying to learn here. My ErgoDoc's easy, and I struggle with this keyboard. But yeah, memory. 652 megs of the 4 gigs of RAM that I gave this machine, and almost no CPU usage. So, yeah, this is what you would expect with an XFCE desktop environment. And RoboLinux just released version 10.5. This release actually just happened, I think, in the last 24 hours. I've never used RoboLinux. I don't know anything about RoboLinux. But apparently it is an Ubuntu-based Linux distribution. It has, I guess, 5 different desktop editions available. I think Cinnamon is their flagship edition, but they also offer XFCE, LXDE. They also offer Mate and GNOME. I'm actually kind of curious to check this out. I'm going to go ahead and download the Cinnamon ISO to take a look at just the live image in just a second. Let's check out the release announcement. It looks like the release announcement is all about security fixes and updates, including a fix for the recent zombie land. They call it the zombie land exploit. It's actually zombie load. I found that funny because I made that mistake myself, actually. When I first heard about zombie load, I thought the article was about the movie Zombieland, which I love. Fantastic movie. Big Woody Harrelson fan. But it's actually a fix for the zombie load exploit. It looks like they offer some one-click app installs, including for I2P, Tor Anonymous Browser, Tor Anonymous Chat, Clam AV, Steam, Wireshark, Google Earth, Opera, Google Chrome. Sounds pretty neat. Let me fire up the live image in a VM. And I'm going to go ahead and download the GNOME edition. Even though their flagship edition is the Cinnamon edition, I can't get to work in VirtualBox for some reason. I know Cinnamon sometimes doesn't play well in VirtualBox, but the live image, I couldn't get it to do anything. It didn't matter what VirtualBox driver I used, and it didn't matter whether I ticked on or off 3D acceleration. It just crashed. It kept constantly crashing and going back to fallback mode. I didn't want to show you guys RoboLinux in that kind of crashy state. That's unfair to RoboLinux, so I'm going to download the GNOME edition. GNOME works just fine in VirtualBox. By the way, I'm downloading it from SourceForge. That's where they host all their images. They also have a Patreon page, so those of you that do use RoboLinux, you know, might consider helping out the developer. I know it's a very small development team. I think as small as just one guy actually creating the distro, so he does have a Patreon that you guys may want to check out. Alright, so the Cinnamon edition didn't want to work for me. I grabbed the GNOME ISO. The GNOME ISO, by the way, was about 3 gigs in size, so a hefty download. The first thing you notice is this kind of has that one-man distro look and feel. It looks like Joe Bob's Garage distro, and I don't mean that in a derogatory way. It's just not a corporate distro. It's not Ubuntu, SUSE, Fedora. You know, it doesn't have that really polished, professional look and feel that you would expect behind either large community projects, you know, or, of course, the big distros that have corporate backing. We have a dock on the side. This appears to be Plank. We have Firefox, of course, the web browser. We're not using the standard GNOME, like, full-screen launcher. We're using a rather traditional paradigm, right? We're a traditional workflow with the panel at the bottom. I don't really care that the panel is 100% transparent. That's an odd choice. But, you know, it's kind of has that Windows 7 kind of paradigm, which is interesting because under all everything that's installed here, we have $10 gift from Robo. What is that? So let's see what clicking on that, does that do anything? Does it launch anything? Let's see. I guess it's a $10, take advantage of Robo's free $10 gift. Since you can use Bitcoin to pay for things, it's becoming very popular. I'm not exactly sure what this is. Yeah. Anyway, I'm going to close that out. That's just strange. We've got some strange stuff here. We have an installer for Windows XP 32-bit in a VM, Windows XP 64-bit in a VM, Windows 7, Windows 10, of course, backup, restore your Windows. Like, this is strange. This is a different kind of distro, but I like that. I like distros that have a purpose, distros that aren't doing the same thing as everybody else. And clearly, this is something different. They have the Budgie Desktop Settings Manager, which is interesting considering it's a GNOME distro, but again, it's a different kind of GNOME. If I just quickly go through the categories, accessories, we have your standard stuff, calculator, the Nautilus file manager. We actually have files and files. Are there two different file managers installed? Okay, that appears to be Nautilus, but it looks like the theming is a little messed up. I'm not sure what that is supposed to be there, actually. If I go to the icon here and click about, yeah, this is files 3.26.4, Nautilus 3.26.4. Nautilus is the proper name. That's strange, but we also had another files right here. Is that the same file manager? No, it's a completely different file manager. What is this? Is this Nemo? Yeah, it is Nemo. Nemo 4.0.6. So again, it's another one of those distros that Nemo's becoming a very popular file manager. Even though it's a GNOME distro, most people are not crazy about Nautilus, so it makes sense to have Nemo installed. We have gedit for plain text editor, of course. Plank was our dock, by the way. Plank is the dock here on the side. Pluma is the text editor. So we have a lot of Mate apps, actually. We have GNU Image Manipulation Program. That, of course, that's the GIMP. Gthumb for an image viewer. We have various installers for some software, maybe software that's not free and open source software. So that's why you need the third-party installer for things like Steam, Opera, Google Chrome. You also have installers for Tor. Tor 64-bit browser, Tor chat, Wireshark installer is also here under Office. We have a calendar, but nothing else. Sound and video, VLC, and Audacious are both here. Brazero for the disk burner. And then we have a bunch of VM stuff, and a lot of the stealth VMs, system tools, you know, the standard stuff here. Anyway, this is just a very quick look at RoboLinux. I wonder if Control-Alt-T brings up a terminal in this distro. It does. If I do a quick uname-r, because the release notes really didn't tell me too much. It's using an older kernel, though, 4.15. So I'm not sure, are they basing off a older version of Ubuntu? So by the way, RoboLinux, I don't know if I mentioned that it is an Ubuntu-based distribution, and I believe the LTS 18.04, the latest kernel on that is 4.15. So I think that is where why they're on version 4.15 here in RoboLinux. So it is a LTS-based release. Is HTOP available on the system? Oh, now GNOME can kind of be bloated, and he's got a lot going on here. This is not your traditional GNOME desktop, but it's pushing over a gig of RAM with really not much going on here. That's kind of typical for GNOME, though. It's kind of a bloated desktop environment. Before I go, you guys know I got to check out the backgrounds. Let's see what kind of wallpapers are available on RoboLinux. It looks like it's a standard GNOME wallpaper pack. Not much to see here. There are a couple of pictures, I think, that were added. Of course, we have the fighter jet here. Another picture of a plane. Looks like a commercial plane. But the rest of it is the standard GNOME wallpaper pack, which is a nice wallpaper pack. Nothing wrong with any of these wallpapers. And that is it for this edition of Distro Roundup. Before I go, I do need to thank a few special people. This show was made possible by Ansem, Chris, the other Chris, Douglas, Dylan, Jack, Leor, Philip, Rob, Robert, and Tony. They are the producers of the show, my highest-tiered patrons over on Patreon. Without those guys, this edition of Distro Roundup would not have been possible. The show is also brought to you by all those fine ladies and gentlemen, all those names you see on the screen. Those guys help support my work over on Patreon. Without those guys, again, this episode of Distro Roundup would not have been possible. If you'd like to consider supporting the channel, please do so. You'll find me at DistroTube over on Patreon. All right, guys. Peace.